if you try and form a lower bound based on logic, well, you shouldn't. You should look at the precise implementation or the procedure. If you do this, you'd find that the minimum should be higher than k log 2.
Yes. Absolutely higher than k log 2. If you just want a single process, I've done the calculations. I can't remember what the numbers are, exact numbers are now, but to get a really modest probability of completion, I don't know, 90% or something, I can't remember the exact numbers, you will certainly create more entropy than the k log 2. It's 0.69k that is the one bit erasure case. If I remember correctly, if you want, I think 95% probability of success, you create 3k of entropy, something like that. But that's only one step. Remember, in a computing device, many steps, right? There isn't just one step. You've got all these steps chained together, and every single one of them is going to be dissipative. This is just a completely basic fact of molecular scale physics. It doesn't take massive, complicated, fancy derivations. The whole thing's done in two lines. You just write down SSK log W, or if you can find different expressions of it. If you go into the Gibbs formalism, SSK log W will be expressed in terms of free energies, but they're all essentially the same result.
This is interesting. So I'm currently writing an article. Maybe it's published already. I'll place it on screen if it's already out. And it's about this word in principle arguments. So my contention is that when most people just use that word, they use it loosely, and you need to scrutinize what kind of in principle are they invoking. So are they referring to epistemological modalities or nomological or metaphysical or logical possibility or something else entirely? And even with these categories, there are frequent ambiguities and doubtfulness within. So what you're suggesting aligns with this. People invoke, in my interpretation of what you've said, Landauer's principle. They're also employing, well, let's just idealize this scenario. Let's say it's an in-principle argument. But then even in such cases, you have to be careful and consider, okay, what are the practical implementations?
Yeah, I'll say more than that. It's an inconsistent application of the idea of in-principle. I think you know a bit of the literature here. It goes back to Szilard's 1929 paper in which he introduced the Szilard engine. Right? Uh-huh. This was a version of the Maxwell daemon. The idea was that you had a one molecule gas that would bounce around inside a chamber. Right? You would insert a partition, trapping the gas on one side, and then you would isothermally expand it, thereby taking heat from the environment and converting it into work. Now, the key thing to understand about that is that the phenomenon that Szilard was looking at is a thermal fluctuation. This was the literature in which he was writing, thermal fluctuations, going back to Szilard and Einstein and Brownian motion and so on. And, the fundamental question that was being asked is, if you look at thermal fluctuations, right, to what extent can they reverse the second law of thermodynamics? So if you look at Brownian motion, for example, think about the Brownian motion in a fluid when the Brownian particle goes up and down. When it's going up, heat from the environment is being converted into some microscopic notion of work because it's being elevated in the gravitational field. Mm-hmm. So Poincaré remarked that in this solar system, we see through our microscope a Maxwell daemon in action, right? So the question then became, is it possible to accumulate all of these microscopic violations of the second law of thermodynamics in order to produce a macroscopic violation of the second law of thermodynamics? Right? That was a serious project that was undertaken in the first decade of the 20th century. Smoluchowski came up with the answer, and the answer is yes, you get fluctuations that you might try and exploit. But every time you try and exploit those fluctuations, you will use other processes that have their own thermal fluctuations that will reverse everything. So this is the example of the Smoluchowski trapdoor. So let's now go back to the Szilard engine. The single molecule bouncing backwards and forwards is a case of a dramatic density fluctuation in a gas. It's the most extreme case, Right? When you have larger numbers of molecules, the fluctuations are very small. As you decrease the number, then the fluctuations become large in relation to the total energy of the gas. And so Szilard's question was, can we somehow exploit those fluctuations and add them up to get a violation of the second law? And the trouble is, when people analyze that, they don't account for all the fluctuations that are in the apparatus that they're using. So think about the way the apparatus works. You start out with the gas, the one molecule gas bouncing around. You put in a partition. The mere fact of putting in a partition, right, is itself a thermodynamic process. If that partition is very light, right, it has it's going to have its energy of a half kt, right, and you have to suppress that energy to get the damn thing to stick, right? Mm-hmm. And that's going to be creating entropy. If you make it very massive so that the amount of KT is not, half KT is not going to produce much motion, right, then you need frictionally to damp it. That's going to produce, you know, so it stops moving, it doesn't bounce out. Now, you know, the short answer is the analysis of the Szilard engine from Szilard's time up to the present simply ignores the totality of fluctuation phenomena that have to be suppressed in order to get the process to go through. So it is, to go back to your original point, it is a selective and incorrect use of, in principle, idealization. You're idealizing away half of the fluctuations, but not the other half. Right? And then you're claiming a result. If you're going to try and exploit fluctuations, you have to treat them consistently and look at the fluctuations throughout the system. If you just pick one particular subset of the fluctuations, you're going to get nonsense results. You probably sense frustration in my voice. This literature has been teetering on the edge of nonsense for 100 years, right? This kind of selective treatment of fluctuations is just disastrous. Of course, you get completely bogus results. The trouble is that every time a formula, P log P, appears, there's a tendency, a natural reaction that says, oh, we have P log P, that must be thermodynamic entropy. No, it must not be. The conditions for a P log P to be associated with heat, in the way that Clausius says, requires that P come about in a very particular way. And the mere fact that I don't know whether, you know, I have a coin, I put it in my pocket, I don't know whether it's heads up or tails up, that isn't the right way for there to be a thermodynamic entropy of K log 2 associated with the coin. But that's the fallacy that's being committed over and over and over again. So there it is.
There was even a Nature article that says that they've experimentally validated Landau's principle.
Oh, my. Yeah, again, they're doing exactly what they shouldn't be doing. What they showed is that I don't remember the details now, but what they showed is that you have a little tiny particle, a colloid or something, that's free to move around like a Brownian particle. And if you compress it, right, by moving a barrier in, you do it slowly so you can get a reversible effect here, then you pass heat of K log 2 to the environment. Well, of course, this has been standard in thermodynamics for over 100 and I don't know how many years. This is just the basic gases of the basic thermodynamics of ideal gases. I did a lot of work on Einstein. It's abundantly clear in Einstein's work on Brownian motion that he understands this perfectly well. It is quite fundamental. If that experiment had failed, right, then we would have to rethink the thermodynamics of ideal gases. So what's wrong with the experiment? Well, they've just looked at how much heat gets generated when you compress a one molecule gas. In effect, it's actually a particle, but sure, it's close enough to being a one molecule gas in its degrees of freedom. If you want to say that we've now instantiated Landau's principle and that's the lower limit, well, that experiment doesn't show it. What about all the entropy that was created in all the other bits of apparatus that were being used? Right, it's a fluctuation phenomenon that you're looking at. What about all the fluctuations that were suppressed in order that you could move your partition inwards? Right, that's all got to be part of the calculation, or you simply don't have a result. And of course, they didn't calculate any of that, so it just I mean, I certainly accept the result. You know,
yes,
a 2-to-1 isothermal compression of a single molecule in an ideal gas will pass kT log 2 of heat to the environment. The same thing will happen if you're in a fluid, right? You have a single Brownian particle, right? That Brownian particle is going to behave like a one molecule gas. This was the brilliance, by the way, of Einstein's analysis of Brownian motion. He realized that you could treat Brownian particles in the same ways you treat molecules. It was a very beautiful analysis.
Yeah, I do want to get to Einstein's views on old quantum theory versus new quantum theory. We'll get to that shortly. So it sounds like what you're saying is Nature's, the article that I've shown, or maybe it'll be on screen again right now, is not validating Landauer's principle. This is something that was predicted before Einstein died, and Landauer came with the principle in the 1960s or so.
It is an easy consequence of the standard thermodynamics of ideal gases. I mean, it's undergraduate physics stuff. Okay, it's lovely that we've done the very particular experiment and seen the result, but boy, it had to be right. You know, if they had any other result coming out, right, and it wasn't the result of some kind of procedural error, it would have been traumatic for statistical physics, because that is so fundamental that if you just have a single component like a molecule, you know, a one molecule gas, and you compress it 2-to-1, you're going to isothermally, you're going to pass kT log 2 of heat reversibly, by the way.
Mm-hmm. If you're hungry for deeper dives into physics, AI, consciousness, philosophy, along with my personal reflections, you'll find it all on my Substack. Subscribers get first access to new episodes, new posts as well, behind-the-scenes insights, and the chance to be a part of a thriving community of like-minded pilgrimers. By joining, you'll directly be supporting my work and helping keep these conversations at the cutting edge. So click the link on screen here, hit subscribe, and let's keep pushing the boundaries of knowledge together. Thank you and enjoy the show. Just so you know, if you're listening, it's curtjaimungal.org, curtjaimungal.org.